Yeah. Hi. My name is Nikita. I'll talk today mostly about the storage technology and why it is time for the storage to come into the browser. Why you need this? What you can? How can you benefit from that? And I'll start with a little of background. So I, for the last like 5 years probably, I mostly work in functional programming languages. So it was Erlang, Clojure, and ClojureScript now. So I write applications for the browser in ClojureScript. And in free time, I do various open source projects. One of them I will talk about today, but this is another one. I will take a minute of your time for shameless safe promotion. This is a programming font with ligatures. It's called FiraCode. It's pretty cool, I think. And the reason I want to announce it is because literally 2 days ago, the GitHub released a new version of Atom editor that Atom that supports ligatures. So finally, it's the first major code editor that allows programming ligatures. So it's pretty cool. Check it out. Thanks. OK. And for the talk, I want to start with the state of the web. All right. So where are we standing at? And how things look in general for the applications. It all started with like thin client idea, which doesn't hold true anymore, right? So right now the application you write in a browser in JavaScript can do anything you want, almost anything you want. So it's just a generic application, and The idea is that we are not writing like client-server architectures anymore. We are writing self-sufficient applications that run that just happens to run in different places, right? So in a browser, you're not writing a client. You're writing an application that has its own processor, state, memory, network, which can communicate over the network to just like the server applications do. So So idea is that if you look at it from this point of view, they're not that different. So client and server are not that different. And I think in the future we will see more of them coming closer together and sharing programming paradigms, technologies, approaches, and stuff like that between client and server, just because they're generally doing the same, right? For today's talk, I think that the time of the storage solutions has already come. So it's already time for the clients to start adopting storages. Just because the applications we write today, not all of them, of course, but we're already seeing a lot of applications that run in a browser that have a complex, big state. And you have to manage it somehow. So the bigger the state is, the more complex your queries are, access patterns are. So the more you want to do about the state, the more you need something to help you with it, right? So you can do it all ad hoc, in an ad hoc way, but it's kind of it will not probably work because, well, you'll not probably spend time to implement all the nice things that databases used to have. So usually people want databases for stuff like that. So you want manage state, you want to operate state, you want to change the state in a predictable way, you want to synchronize state, right? So synchronization is usually tied up with the storage solutions, right? So storage needs to have some properties for synchronizations to work, so they're usually tied close together. The solution I'm going to talk today is called DataScript. It's a project I write, it's open source. And it is essentially it's lightweight in memory data structures that Yeah, that runs in a browser. And it happens to have all the properties of a database. I usually call it a database, but it's something more lightweight, or if you want to decomplect it, something like that. I think we should dive in and see more about it. So it looks like, when I say it have most of the properties of the database, it does it, but in kind of a different way, right? So the idea of DataScript was based on a commercial database, Clojure database called Datomic. They have a lot of good ideas in it, and it happens that they could be ported for a browser where they still make sense. So I took the model of the Datomic and I ported it into the browser, made it open source, and I'm going to talk about it right now. So yeah, so data model. You expect, relational databases usually have tables, right? So they store data in tables. It's not true for DataScript. In DataScript, the storage is simpler. It stores all the data in tuples. Tuples contain entity, attribute, and value. And it looks like this. So here we see that we know two facts about entity number one. We know its name and we know its age. We know three facts about the entity number two and only one fact about entity number three, right? So why it is made that way? The first one, it's more flexible. You don't need to pre-allocate the structure to pre-allocate the schema to describe which attributes you are going to have. The second one is that it's a better fit for different irregular data patterns. So for example, if you have sparse or irregular data, you don't pay the overhead of having empty columns in a table, right? Which relational databases do. It's also a natural fit for multi-valued attributes. For example, you see that friends here is multi-valued, so a person is allowed to have multiple friends. In SQL databases, it usually ends up with additional table and all the pain related to it. Here, it's just naturally supported. We support reverse references, so we don't have we can not only reference this way, but we can access a reference another way. So we can check friends of a person and whom this person is friend of. And another property from the relational world, from database, is indexes. Indexes are good if you have a big state, right? So if you have tens of thousands items or hundreds of thousands items, which is, I think, is pretty much a reality nowadays. Not everybody needs it, but there are applications that need it. And indexes are the way to access such data set in an efficient way, right? So you will probably never write an index if you are using ad hoc solution, except probably, primary key. So you can put all your data in hash map and you will get fast primary key access, but you will not get the access from, for example, by value. So I have an index of persons, and I want to find all the persons that have certain name or which have age bigger than something. So indexes allow you to do lookups anyway. So you have you are storing your data like this in a flat structure, and the benefit of it is you can access it by row, by column, by Vulkan references, and stuff like that. So anyways you want. So you have a big data set and you need to look at it from different, points of view. And it's easy to do with technology like that. Another big achievement of this is queries, right? So the SQL in a server-side world is pretty much great. So it's declarative, it's compact, engines can optimize it. You are saying what you need, but you don't say how you need to get it, and it's a good thing, right? So it has its downsides, but what's a good it's a good way to express complex data needs or queries in your program. In DataScript, we have query language. It's not SQL, as I said. Everything is kind of different. It's called DataLog, and it has the same expressive power as SQL has, plus it can express recursion. So you can write recursive queries, and it is good for like traversing the hierarchies or graphs. So if you have a graph of friends, you can write a query where we kind of will see it. Yeah, okay, so this is an example of a query in DataLog. I'm not going to like explain everything here because we can spend a couple of hours. But yeah, so the general idea that happens here, we have a query that accepts database and a person's email and finds this person. Then it finds a department it works in. Then it finds all the persons that work in the same department. So here is join happens. Then it finds the salary of each person, so another join. And after that, it do two aggregates. It calculates total salary and average salary of, so we get a department total salary and average salary of a department the person works in, something like that. Yeah, so it's pretty compact and pretty, another cool thing here is, it's in Clojure syntax. You can write the same query in JavaScript. I just don't have an example here. And the good thing here is it's data structure. So it's list of expressions, and you can programmatically build it. It's marginally better than SQL when you have to concatenate strings and all the crazy rules about where the comma should go and stuff like that. It's kind of bad. Another example, as I said, recursive queries. It's a query when you you find a transitive friend. So if there is a chain of friends between A and B, we say the any B is a friend. If there is a direct link, or there is some person X that is friend with A and is friend with a B. So it's kind of logical programming. DataLog is based on Prolog somehow, I think. Something like that. Again, this is an example of a recursive query. And that's not all I can say about the queries. There are a couple of superpowers about them. So you can run the same queries over collections, right? So it's not only works over the database, it also works over the plain collections like arrays or maps or lists. You can feed in multiple databases. So database is a in-memory thing, so you don't have to set up something complex. You can have multiple databases, obviously. And they can have different info. For example, one can have salaries, another can have emails, something like that. You can put all the databases into a single query and execute join between them. Works just fine. You can mix, of course, collections, databases. And you can use user-defined functions. For example, during the query, you find a person you need to calculate some complex expression to just to check if this person should be in a query or we should exclude it. And you can just pass in a user-defined function that will be executed during the run of the query. Continuing about superpowers, so the database actually is immutable, right? So we just heard the talk about immutability and the benefits of it, how it works for database. It works just the same way. Database is a value that you cannot change, but you can write, you can have a function that takes the current value of database, applies some changes to it, and returns you a new value of the database. So leaving the initial value intact, so it doesn't change. The new value is completely different reference. You can access the old one, you can access the new one, you can forget one, and it will be garbage collected. If you don't, well, you can work with both. So the whole database, no matter how big it is, it's just a value. It's truly immutable. You can change it. Yeah, it doesn't have any hidden state. It doesn't have any complex data process. So it's just an in-memory data structure. And yeah, immutability is pretty great for all the same reasons. It's great for immutable data structures and immutable strings, right? So it's easiest the testing, the concurrent programs. We don't have concurrency in JavaScript, but we have it in JVM, for example. So it doesn't cause any problems if you're running it concurrently. It doesn't, mess up with the database if you run some test and just see what happens and test fails or not fails. Not everything stays perfect fine. You can run what if speculations, so you have a database, you want to see what will happen, how the state will look like, how my target function will look like if the database will contain just slightly different set of facts. So you just transact that facts to the database, you check the new value, and then you throw it away and continue with the old one. And one of the biggest benefits is history tracking. So you can track all the states of the database you are using, for example, in application. You're using a database for storing the state of your application, so you can track all the states your application has been into. And you can do it efficiently, right? So just as with persistent data structures, DataScript is a persistent data structure under the hood. If you have multiple databases that were created one from another by transacting like small values, so for example, the first database is a very, very big database with, 1 million facts, and you add one more and one more and one more, and in the end you have 1,000,005 facts. All of them will share the big part of the internal state, they will be all different and small parts that actually changes, right? So they all will reference the same big chunk of memory. It will not be copied over, so you don't pay the overhead of copying the big chunk of memory to just get a new database. It will reused. So it's a practice that functional languages employ for data structures, and it works just fine for a database. So basically, internally, the database is just a sorted, persistent sorted set. Transactions. Transactions you also expect from a database, right? So, or if you, well, they, again, they make more sense in a concurrent environment where multiple entities can change your database, for example. In JavaScript, not so much, but still. Yeah, there are a couple of nice properties for transactions as well. One of them is that transactions are serializable. So it means the transaction is actually a data structure that looks like that. It's actually a list of just the changes, right? So the first change is we assert a new fact about the entity number one. The second and the third sort of come together. It's actually a rename. So we delete the fact about the name of the person number two, and we assert a new fact about the same person with different names. So basically, it works like a rename. And so all the transactions are reduced to the form like this, which can be sent over the network, which can be stored in local storage, for example, something like that. So basically, you not only have a database, you also have changes that happens with your database, you can have them as a data structure that can be serialized, right? So it, and it is better than having, for example, a function. If you would have just a function to change the database, well, you can send the change over the network. You can send a function over the network. But you can send the data, yes? And yeah, you can embed, actually, it's not, this is pretty Spartan. It's actually more featured than that, but they're mostly cosmetic features. You can embed user functions inside the transaction, like during the transaction, you can run a query over the database, current state, and generate new fact just while the transaction is executing. It, yeah, it works just fine. And another good news for this is that if you have this stream of transactions going through the database, you can listen for it, right? So there is a special facility for listening for this transactions queue. So you just subscribe and you get all the transactions that come through the database, meaning that you can listen to it, you can react to it, you can build, for example, if you are using it for application state, you can update your user interface, right? You can update user interface, you can run data synchronization with the server or something like that. So basically, the reactive features. And yeah, and because transaction is a data structure, you can actually reuse the query engine to run the queries over the transaction data. So for example, you're just looking, you're interested in changing of a name, right? So you just query if the current transaction have something related to a change of a name. If it doesn't, you ignore it. If it does, you update the specific part of your user interface that displays that username, something like that. And a couple of future benefits that are not yet in a code base, but will be eventually one way or another. I think one of them is persistence. So as I said, DataScript is in-memory data structure. So you, it only exists in memory. It's not persistent. You can, you don't, it doesn't communicate with local storage or something by default, right? But you can do it right now, of course, by serializing the whole database. And more and better way to do it is to have the support for it in indexes. Indexes are simple B-trees, the same data structure used in all the databases, server-side databases. And it can work like with partially realized indexes, meaning you can have a big index stored in local storage, for example, and you can just deserialize and load only parts that your queries, your query touch, and it can run over it works on demand, right? So you only need those parts of the indexes that you actually touch. And it means that you can do a pretty much efficient serialization for DataScript. With pluggable storage, of course, we don't ask much from storage. The storage needs just store by key and load by key. And probably for concurrent environment, it will need compare and swap. It's pretty much doable. But it's not there yet, but will be eventually. And another property you probably need. Even though the application is self-sufficient and runs in a browser, it usually needs to talk to someone, right? So the application that doesn't communicate, it's not that interesting, at least in a browser. So most of the in-browser applications communicate, and communication is hard, right? We have this conference, I think we have 5 or 6 talks about just this problem alone, how to propagate changes between, synchronize changes between client and the server. And even if you have two databases, like client and server, it's already hard. In reality, you have end-to-end, you have multiple devices per user, and you have replicated storage on the server, so it's super hard. And well, yeah, because of asynchronicity, it just gets down to this, everything will change all the time in no particular order. So it's complete chaos, which you supposed somehow to make sense of. And DataScript can help there in a way. It doesn't completely solve this problem. Well, it doesn't solve this problem at all, but the properties the DataScript has helps you to solve this problem for yourself in kind of better ways than you will do with, I don't know, mutable storage, for example, mutable ad hoc storage, right? So the one thing is linear logs. So as I said, the log of transactions that go through database is linear. If you have the same log on the server, well, on the server it may be a queue or datomic database which has the same log. The problem gets down to just synchronizing two linear logs, which kind of solvable to a way, except conflicts, right? We can send the transactions over the network, which also helps, right? So the changes that happens are already in the data form, and we can run optimistic local updates. So for example, if you are offline, you have a DataScript database, and user trying to do something with your application, the changes he generates, you can apply them to local database first, so he immediately see what he's done, and in the background you can synchronize them. Yeah, and well, at the moment of synchronization, there's well, two pitfalls. The first, you might be offline. It's okay, right? So you just retry later. And the second one, it may cause a conflict because well, while you're touching your application, somebody on server changed something, and now server wants his changes applied to you, and you want your changes applied to server. In that case, well, you can apply the server's change. You can roll back your optimistic local updates because database is immutable. You have the old state of database, or you can calculate it because the format of these transactions is reversible. You actually, given this, you can generate exactly the transaction that rolls back this. And well, you still have to manually resolve conflicts somehow, but DataScript kind of helps you rolling back, trying local updates, stuff like that. Yeah, so I'm wrapping up. The DataScript, it is intentionally designed as small, focused, and decomplected, meaning that all the different parts are independent. Like you have storage, you have queries, which know how work with the storage, but you can work on collections and stuff. You have transactions, and they all work together, but well, can be interchanged, and you can build different things if you don't like some parts of it. It plays well with the R, so it tries to do the minimal thing well, right? So it doesn't have a lot built in, like it doesn't have persistence built in, it doesn't have synchronizations built in, but they are possible as a library, and I think the DataScript is a good foundation for building stuff like that. It is currently used in a couple of production projects. Some of them, this one I work in, the Cognition, and other ones, well, sort of applications in a browser, right? That's it. Thanks for the listening, and I will take questions now. Okay, I guess we need to remove this jQuery question, right? I think jQuery is dead. Well, browsers do what jQuery tried to do. Well, we have document query selector, so I don't know why you need anything else. Advice on using DataScript from JS, yes, no, how? Oh, yeah, sorry, I forgot to say that DataScript is, well, it initially was written in ClojureScript with JavaScript API, so you can include it as a JavaScript library and do most of the things, I hope all the things from JavaScript. Just I don't have a production customer who is using it from JavaScript, so I'm not completely sure, but it has pretty good coverage and test suite for JavaScript. And it works on the GVM as well. So ClojureScript and Clojure are dialect of the same language for the browser and for GVM. So I ported it back to the GVM, and now you can run it on a server and on a client. And that's why I was talking about the immutability and in concurrency, because you can run it on a server. Yes, no, how, is there a need for more JSCRP suggestions? Yeah, so there is JavaScript API, you can use it and it mostly works. I think it can be improved, but I need a feature request or something about it, because I personally use it from ClojureScript and Clojure. What about performance of DataScript? How many records is able to handle effectively real time? Is there any backend part of the DataScript to synchronize data with DB? Yeah, so performance is okay-ish. the question is, the indexes are B-trees, pretty wide, so it doesn't actually matter how big your database is. Like, you can store 100,000 items with no sweat. You can probably store 1,000,000. The problem, the most time-consuming operation is filling in a database, right? So if you have a page, if you're trying to fill in database on page initialization, you will need to get all the data into the indexes. So you need to sort it. So the most limiting factor is sorting the data that comes from a server if you're doing it on each page load. If you are storing database like in local storage, as I said, with, for example, indexes, persistence based on internal index structure, which is not there yet, it should be better, right? So you, well, okay. But if you're downloading like 1,000,000 items on each page load, you probably already have a slow application. So it's not exactly DataScript bottleneck here. So yeah, I can answer it like the size of a database doesn't matter that much. The initialization time depends on the size of the database. And if you run a query that returns a lot of data or scans or a lot of the, or joins a lot of data, of course it will be slow, right? But it will be slow anyways. I don't think DataScript adds something there. So the answer is, I guess, that you need to have your head turned on. And you need to be aware of the size of data sets you are operating with, right? So some things are impossible just because you're just asking to do a query over just a lot of data. It's impossible anyways, not because of DataScript. Is there any backend part of this to synchronize data with DB? No, there isn't, but there will be a talk tomorrow by Sean Groove about Dato. It's a data synchronization library for Datomic and DataScript, so you might be interested in that. Won't immutability cause performance issues when working with larger data sets? I think it won't. I mean, so immutability, how do I put it? As I said, immutable data structure shares the data structure. If you have a 1,000,000 database, it items database, and you add a new item into it, you're just copying over a pretty small part of the tree that doesn't depend on the size of the initial database, right? So overhead of putting new data in the database doesn't depend on the size of the database. So it's pretty effective, I think. And for example, at least it's better than JavaScript arrays, which have to reallocate all the time if you put new data into them, if you grow them, and if the, for example, the array is super big, and you want one more item into it, you have to copy it over into a new allocated buffer, right? So in that case, it will depend. I'm talking about JavaScript mutable arrays, right? So in that case, it depends on the size of initial data set. For immutable structures, it doesn't depend on it. So yeah, something like that. Could you give an example of the DataScript production usage? Yeah, well, on the GitHub page or on my slide, there was six projects that are using DataScript in production. Why not implement enchaining API instead of query syntax? Yeah, to okay. This is a kind of design question. Oh, query syntax is okay. Yeah, how do I put it? So the idea of the queries in general is that you can optimize the query as a whole, right? If you have a query, the query engine, in theory at least, can look at what you need, what you start with, what you need, what will happen before doing any real work. And it can make decisions to do all what you're asking it about in kind of optimal way, right? At least you have this possibility. For this chaining API, you're just telling the engine what it has to do in what exact order, right? So it has less less room for improvement. Well, it means, I mean, in general, right? For the DataScript, I don't know. It doesn't matter that much because we don't have query optimizer, and queries are kind of executed one expression after another. There are some optimizations in between. So for example, in chaining API, I don't know. So the basic idea was to support the datomic syntax first, and when I get there, I don't think I need something else. So if there is a need for chaining API and I can see the benefits of it, I can of course add it. So it just, I just didn't so far. How would you serialize a conditional transaction? For example, withdraw money only if user has enough funds. Yeah, so yeah, the idea is this serializable format of a transaction is a result of like executed transaction, right? So you have a database, you apply some function to it, you apply a transaction to it which contains conditional function or something like that, and it executes over this exact value of a database, and it produces the changes that happens on during that transaction. So, and that part is serializable, and you can send it over. And if you want to apply the same transaction on a different database, well, it's not kind of possible, I guess. Yes. So the serialization of transactions is for deltas between database states, something like that, right? It's not for the code that you execute. So you cannot serialize like a transaction before you execute it, something like that. What about concurrent? Well, I don't know. Just I don't know who is asking these questions, and I don't know if I answer them or no. But okay. How do you obtain concurrency on an immutable database? Well, you just don't change the value. So if you don't change the value, it's concurrent. You can access it from multiple threads. It doesn't change. Is it possible to transparently synchronize it with a backend? Yeah, okay. Again, you probably need to see a data talk tomorrow. Why do reactivity and functional programming appear to be the way to go in front-end programming, but not so clearly in back-end programming? Well, if you've seen the Scala guys started the reactive movement, I guess, on the back-end especially, so Java has streams, if I don't mistake. Go has channels and stuff like that. Well, Erlang has message passing. So the push paradigm has been there on a server for a long time. And well, probably the only thing that is not as widely adopted is functional reactive programming, right? So, but it sees its way in a Scala community, at least. And that's what I am aware of. Looks like NoSQLDB on the client side, if I am corrected, what's the difference with a CouchDB? Yeah, okay, this is a great question. It is NoSQL just because it doesn't support SQL. It supports something better, so I'm not sure you can call it NoSQL. So CouchDB is kind of limited. You only have primary key access. You don't have queries. You don't have transactions that modifies multiple values at once. You don't have a lot of things, right? You don't have you have indexes, but you have to build them manually, something like that. So just much more featured.
Cool. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.